everyone. I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 in Manila, 10 in Tokyo, and 9 p.m. in New York. The headlines. Asian markets trading cautiously this morning following Wall Street's longest losing streak since January, with tech mega caps in the spotlight. Here at home, Philippine shares finally snapped a 9-day losing streak on Wednesday as investors went bottom fishing. The main index kicking off from 64.50 today. The National Grid Corporation of the Philippines expects Luzon to stay on yellow alert until Friday, while Visayas continues to experience thinning reserves until next week. China Bank's total cash dividends climbed to an all-time high of 5.9 billion pesos in payout. That's up 16% year-on-year. And later, we turn our focus to a Filipino animation director who recently bagged an international award for his animated film, Sulaiman. Begin with stocks. Asian markets seen taking cautious approach today as Wall Street peers suffer their longest losing streak since January. As you can see, Japanese stocks are down from the start of trade, while those in Australia and South Korea are trading up the Kospi Index by a hefty 1.1%. Futures for Hong Kong indicating early losses, while similar contracts in China are seeing modest gains. Following declines in U.S. megacaps, investors will be closely watching Asian chipmakers as Tokyo Electron, SK Hynix, and Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing all release earnings today. Europe's most valuable tech firm, ASML Holdings, said on Wednesday orders tumbled in the first quarter and its China sales are likely to be hampered by U.S. export control measures. Now, aside from semiconductors, spotlight will also be on currencies after the U.S. dollar, the mighty U.S. dollar, fell for the first time in 6 days yesterday. The Japanese yen also plunging almost 9%, while South Korea's won has dropped roughly 7% this year against the U.S. dollar. Now, elsewhere, we know that oil slumped more than 3% on Wednesday, weighed by weaker Chinese industrial data, while gold slipped by about 0.9%. Now, stateside, let's take a look at how futures are looking. Looking little changed with an upside risk there, especially led by the NASDAQ. Futures up by a 0.5%, followed by the S&P up by a 0.1%. So here's a recap of Wall Street's activity overnight. The U.S. stock market extended its losing streak to the longest since January as a handful of rate-sensitive big techs were sold off. There's a lot of nerves creeping into semiconductor stocks, which have led the recent rallies, and there are now concerns whether their growth and earnings will actually support frothy valuations. AI darling Nvidia swung to losses, falling nearly 4%, joining fellow big tech names like Netflix, Meta, and Apple. U.S. equities now down for a fourth straight day. Look at that. The S&P 500 down by over 0.5%, 50.22, while the tech-heavy NASDAQ slid by 1.2%. The Dow also falling over 0.1%. It's in seventh negative session in the last eighth.
I think the markets today and this week are continuing to move on the same themes that we've been moving on the last few weeks since the turn of the quarter, which is market participants are waking up to the fact that on the macro level, the data is pretty comfortable for the Federal Reserve to pretty much stay the course as to where they are. So inflation is uncomfortably high and not coming down as quickly as everyone had hoped. But GDP growth, employment figures, retail sales, all of those data points are strong and strong enough to let the Federal Reserve say, we're just going to kind of wait a little bit further before we do anything in terms of lowering rates. And where that's come over the course of this calendar year is there were a lot of participants expecting 5 to 6 rate cuts coming into 2024. Though the Federal Reserve never said that there was going to be 5 to 6 rate cuts. Those expectations have been tempered down to about 2 to 3. And now we're kind of looking at maybe 1 to 2.
Looking at some highlights from corporate America, we're watching Morgan Stanley, which sold $8 billion worth of bonds on Wednesday following its release of better than expected quarterly revenue. And U.S. President Joe Biden vowing to keep United States steel American-owned, as he sought to woo union workers ahead of this November's election. Now, here's a look at the local corporate headlines we're watching this morning. Let's start with Manila Water Philippine Ventures. It's a wholly owned subsidiary of Manila Water, which entered into a share purchase agreement with Equiparco Holdings Corporation, Metropac Water Investments, and Twin Peak Hydro Resources Corporation. This is for the purchase of their 30%, 30%, and 10% interest, respectively, in a company called Equipacific Holdco, or EHI. The total purchase price is 1.15 billion pesos. The company says the acquisition will allow it to establish a stronger foothold and grow its water and wastewater supply operations in the province of Laguna. And China Bank declares record cash dividends of 5.9 billion pesos payout. That's a 16% increase year on year. This also represents 27% of the bank's 2023 net income of 22 billion pesos, roughly translating to a cash dividend yield of 6%. China Bank, the country's fourth largest private domestic bank, says the latest development reflects its commitment to provide good shareholder returns while investing in the continued growth of its business. The regular cash dividend there of 1.20 per share is actually 20% higher year on year as well. Moving on, real estate firm Housetalk launches two new projects in Antipolo. One is called The Hammond. It's a 1.6-hectare economic complex of single-attached townhomes in Hinapo Village, Antipolo. It expects this project to yield around 580 million pesos in revenues from the 161 units with a base price of 3.6 million pesos. The other project, a little bit cheaper, known as Ellery Homes, marks the firm's inaugural venture into condo development. It's expecting to rake in some 260 million pesos from 144 units offered at a much lower price of 1.8 million pesos. Both projects will be marketed starting the third quarter of this year. And finally, Basic Energy Corporation has signed a joint development and shareholders agreement with Japanese renewable energy and publicly listed firm Renova Incorporated. The company says the agreement will advance the development of the 4,800-hectare Mabini Wind Energy Project in Batangas. The project is expected to generate a capacity of around 50 megawatts. Now, for some news from the country's top regulator, the Securities and Exchange Commission upholds its cease and desist order against the MFT Group, led by CEO Maria Francesca Mica Tan, Foundry Ventures, and its officers and agents concerning its alleged illegal sale of investment contracts to the public. The Commission on Bank had issued the CDO back in January after the MFT Group, which later on transitioned to Foundry Ventures, was found to have engaged in the unlawful solicitation, offer, and or sale of securities in the form of investment contracts without the necessary license from the SEC. Based on complaints, the group had solicited investments supposedly for startup companies in exchange for a guaranteed return ranging from 12 to 18% per annum. The group had also issued post-dated checks that were never paid. And in a bid to boost capital market activity, the SEC has removed the minimum amount of commission that stockbrokers may charge their customers. This means brokers are allowed to set their own commission schedule without the limitations of a prescribed regulatory minimum commission. For context, a 1977 resolution by the SEC had previously set the broker's commission at 1.5%, while guidelines issued by the PSC prescribed a minimum commission ranging from 0.25% to 0.05% of the value of a trade transaction. The removal of the minimum commission takes into account the rise of online trading platforms, which have paved the way to more cost-efficient transactions. It also empowers the public to engage the services of a broker based on cost preference. The Philippine peso slides to a 17-month low, but the central bank does not see it as large enough to derail the much-anticipated monetary easing later this year or early next year. Lady Vicencio has more.
The Banco Central ng Pilipinas is not alarmed with the peso's depreciation after falling to 57 level against the U.S. dollar on Tuesday. On Wednesday, the local currency slipped further against the dollar, closing at 57.18. The central bank attributed the peso's slide to geopolitical tensions. and speculation over the U.S. Federal Reserve's next steps.
I wouldn't say it's performing poorly. I would say it's adjusting to some events. It initially weakened, along with other emerging market currencies, by the way, because of what's going on in the Middle East.
Remolona added that the decline may have been a reaction to Fed Chairman Jerome Powell's signal that rate cuts in the U.S. may come later than expected.
I think it's adjusting to Powell's speech that maybe they won't ease until September. September's kind of how people interpret what Powell said. So there's a postponement of when the FOMC will ease in the eyes of the market. So that has meant weakening of other currencies against the U.S. dollar. So it's not a case of a weak peso, it's a case of a strong dollar.
The weakening of the peso is not sharp enough for Remolona to warrant adjusting interest rates. With Philippine inflation accelerating for two consecutive months, the BSP earlier said policy easing may not come soon as inflation risks continue to lean on the upside. He said the Monetary Board may instead reconsider cutting rates this year.
The central scenario would be fourth quarter ease. If things are worse than we think, then might be postponed to the first quarter of 2025.
While the adjustment has not been significant enough to affect monetary policy, Remolona said it could be a factor in the Monetary Board's next policy meeting. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
Just a bit of a background, the deputy governor is in Washington, Francis Tequila Jr., and he gave more specific numbers for upside expectations in inflation. They're saying that there are more upside risks to inflation. They're seeing inflation breach the BSP's target of 2-4% in the second quarter of this year before easing back to within that range in the second half. For the entire year, they expect inflation to average around 3.8% with a risk-adjusted forecast at 4%. Now, for the first time in over a decade, a prime minister from New Zealand will be visiting Manila. Wellington Prime Minister Christopher Luxon is scheduled to meet President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. later today, Thursday. The agenda to advance the two countries' nearly 60-year relationship. Luxon will be accompanied by a business delegation and the Minister of Climate Change and Revenue. Last year, New Zealand ranked as Manila's 28th largest trading partner out of 230, with total trade amounting to $495 million. It is the Philippines' 38th export destination and 24th import source. New Zealand also became the Philippines' 22nd top source of visitors, with over 29,000 tourists recorded in 2023. The country sees a very promising start for exports this year. Preliminary data from the Philippine Statistics Authority show merchandise exports jumped 16% to $5.9 billion, driven by a recovery in semiconductors. The month actually saw the highest value of semiconductor exports recorded in February over the last 10 years. This brings total exports in the January to February period to $11.8 billion, up 12%. Electronic products, which constitute nearly 63% of the total, grew by 27%. Among the Philippines' top export markets, the United States, Hong Kong, China, South Korea, the Netherlands, and Taiwan. Now, Hong Kong notably recorded the largest increase, with imports growing by 45.6% year-on-year, while Singapore saw the most significant decline. Video conference app Zoom vows to address communication gaps in the highly hybrid working world following its acquisition of WorkVivo. WorkVivo is an employee communication and engagement platform for companies to better connect with their employees digitally. More companies have been allowing their employees to work in a hybrid setup in the years following the height of the COVID-19 pandemic and lockdown, which forced several employees to work remotely.
Hybrid world is very productive. There's also a level of disconnectedness from the company, sometimes from people when they're working from home. And we wanted to solve that problem, really, helping companies and senior executives really create that sense of culture, that sense of belonging for employees, which is why we acquired a company called WorkVivo. We have customers in the Philippines also. And that's a platform we acquired that really is around creating employee experience, helping companies communicate, broadcast their messages, their strategies, but in a very rich, immersive world with a very social fabric, video, microsites, which frankly, younger populations love, mm-hmm. especially in the Philippines where, you know, it's a very social, connected young population.
Shifting gears now, Philippine transport regulators looking into claims that public transport services are losing passengers to motorcycle taxis. Several transport groups made that allegation, including the Taguig Transport Service Cooperative, which operates modern jeepneys. It warns the situation could get worse once more motorcycle taxis get the green light to operate formally and officially.
Hindi ako naniniwala na yung pasahero ng motorcycle taxi, hindi namin pasahero. Yung pasahero namin, pasahero nila. Kasi why? Napapasok nila ang subdivision. Diba? Yung tricycle, mawawala ng pasahero, makukuha nila.
Transport officials, meanwhile, gave assurance the result of their probe will be included in government's expanded motorcycle taxi pilot study, which will be submitted to lawmakers on May 30th. The study will serve as a guide for lawmakers in crafting a law governing motorcycle taxi operations in the Philippines.
Marami po ang nagsasabi na nawawalan na ng pasahero si ganito, si ganyan. But we have to validate because iba po kasing klaseng transportation or mode of transportation ng motorcycle taxi. Unang-una, wala pong ruta yung mga yan. And yung pong mga UV, PUB, yan po, may mga ruta po kasi yung mga yan. So, isa, special po yung mga TODA, may areas of operation po yan. Now, yan po ang isa sa mga tinututukan namin ngayon. So, titingnan natin kung meron po ba at kung meron, gaano po ba kalaki ang impact of motorcycle taxi operation doon po sa ibang mga klase ng pampublikong sasakyan.
Philippine transport officials also unfazed by the threat of more transport strikes against the PUV modernization program. Manibela and Piston, which just finished their two-day protest against the controversial modernization scheme, have warned of more protest actions ahead of the April 30 consolidation deadline. Transport regulators assert they are ready for more protests.
Talagang napipinpoint na rin kung saan ang talagang problema or concern every time they go do Tigil Pasada. So the service of the government to our commuters mas nagiging maganda.
Under the PUV modernization program, jeepney operators have until the end of this month to consolidate into cooperatives which will replace their fleet with supposedly safer and less polluting vehicles. But some transport groups refuse to do so, saying the modernization scheme could result in the loss of their livelihoods. The power grids of Luzon and Visayas remain on alert amid the extreme heat that caused electricity demand to spike. Philippine grid operator NGCP says it will put the Luzon grid under red alert today, Wednesday, from 3 to 4 p.m. and from 8 to 10 p.m., while the Visayas power grid will be under yellow alert from 1 to 9 p.m. NGCP expects the Luzon power grid to be under yellow alert until Friday, while the Visayas power grid is expected to remain under yellow alert or experiencing thinning reserves until next week. The Energy Department earlier said the Philippines saw the highest electricity consumption this Wednesday at over 13,200 megawatts. Now, here is a look at the other stories we're tracking in the newsroom today. Happening within the hour, state-run pension. A social security system will conduct coverage drive and mapping operations. Well, in the next hour at around, that's 10, government agencies will discuss their crisis plan for Filipino migrant workers in case of a wider conflict in the Middle East. Still at 10 a.m. Cebu Pacific, will be presenting its new measures to enhance safety and customer service. While at noon, Converge ICT will hold its Surf's Up event at Mi'ia Terminals 1 and 2. Plus, as we reported earlier, New Zealand's Prime Minister Christopher Luxon will be arriving in Manila for an official visit. Now, before we go for a quick break, we have this just in. This is the news we've been waiting for all week. Balay ni Frutas of Leicester U has entered into an agreement to acquire or to buy the 40-year-old legacy brand Sugar House for an undisclosed amount. Again, Balay ni Frutas of Leicester U is buying the brand Sugar House for a still undisclosed amount. All right. We'll take a quick break. We give you the opening numbers at the Philippine Stock Exchange after the local bourse snapped a 9-day losing streak yesterday. Plus, our market chat with Rustine Mercado of China Bank Securities. That's next. Market Edge. We'll be right back. You're still watching Market Edge. The headlines, a surge in Chinese students in Cagayan Province and reports of Chinese nationals buying land near major ports and military sites, raising security concerns. China warns the joint military exercises of the Philippines and the U.S. will only undermine regional stability. And the Philippine Supreme Court asks the Senate to comment on a petition to nullify the arrest warrant for fugitive pastor Apollo Quiboloy. The Philippine Stock Exchange wants to double the number of Filipinos trading stocks in the country. This through user-friendly mobile apps that will make it easier for the public to invest in the capital market. Jackie Pascual tells us more.
The Philippine Stock Exchange is hopeful that the number of Filipinos trading stocks will grow significantly with the launch of mobile services such as G-Stocks. PSE President and CEO Ramon Monzon says there are 1.9 million stock market accounts in the country, an 11.8% increase over a five-year period, but still a low number at just 1.7% of the population.
Hopefully, at least in the next 5 years, if they could double that 1.9, it's good enough for us because it took us 94 years to get there.
The PSE has one of the lowest retail market participation rate in the region at 16% compared to 32% of Indonesia Stock Exchange and 28.9% of Stock Exchange of Thailand.
Retail participation in any stock market contributes to the liquidity of the market. And the market liquidity is very important to make the market go up. Increase in value.
Antonio Jose Periquet Jr. of AB Capital says there are many possible reasons why Filipinos are not into trading stocks.
Some people say it is lack of incomes, therefore lack of savings. One other hypothesis is because Filipinos simply do not have an equity culture. We have a lotto culture, a wetting culture, a sabong culture, a gaming culture, but an equity culture we don't have. Now, is that true?
But he believes it's mostly because of a lack of access to such services, which is why AB Capital partnered with GCash to create G-Stocks, making it easier for the average Filipino to buy or sell stocks.
Without digital means, it's simply too intimidating for the average Filipino to walk into a broker's office, to open an account, to fill up these forms.
How do we help Filipinos grow their money, earn money, right? And stocks is one of the things that we're looking at.
Layug reveals that G-Stocks already has 500,000 users following its soft launch last year. Officials are confident that with the convenience offered by this online platform, more Filipinos would now be more willing to trade stocks, expanding the country's capital market sector. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine shares recovered on Wednesday from its steepest drop this year, with the PSE index rebounding back to 64.50, while the Philippine peso weakened past 57 to the dollar for the first time since late 2022. For more, let's bring in Rustine Mercado, Director for Research at China Bank Securities. Rustine, hi, good morning.
Hi, Mimi. Good morning.
I'm still waiting for the official opening numbers from the stock exchange, but let's take a look at what's happening in the market here. Rate cuts have been backing up, the schedule, the timeline, even the depth. And markets clearly have not liked it. Is there more bad news coming? I mean, what else could lead us to even more downside?
Well, I think a little bit of context first, right? The recent weakness was also due to Fed foreign selling. And again, that's primarily driven by a later rate cut. So that's around over $4 billion so far in the month, and we're just halfway through, right? And that's because there's some unwinding of some bets, especially for EMs, because of the later rate cut from the Fed. Now, again, the reason why we went up in the first place, the first quarter, was it was partly fueled by optimism that you're going to see start seeing rate cuts, possibly around March, and then got moved back to June, and then now I think we're moving back into the tail end of the year, right? And apart from that, recent developments on the geopolitical side of things have also kept investors defensive, because of course that might lead to higher commodity prices, risk appetite obviously is going to go down. So that also feeds into the outlook for inflation. So I think to answer that question, is there any more bad news coming and what are we monitoring? A couple of things. So first is Fed speak, right? We want to see where the Fed's head is at with respect to rate cut timings. They've come out with their dot plot, I think last month, saying that probably still 3 rate cuts, but I think that has changed given the economic data we've seen in the past week. And then you have the next Fed policy meeting coming up in the next 2 weeks. So we'll see if that changes. Obviously, if they push back their rate cuts or if they significantly douse rate cuts hopes this year, then we might see further weakness in the market, at least temporarily. And then developments in the Middle East, obviously, as a key concern here. An escalation of tensions there could have a potential impact on both oil prices and investor appetite for risky assets. So I think in terms of what we're monitoring, those two things could potentially drive market action if there's a negative development, possibly continued weakness.
So where are you expecting this market to go in the short term? We're now at 64.50, right where we ended last year. I'm actually looking at data. December 29, we ended at 64.50.04. Ah, that's where we're kicking off today, 64.50.04. It's a flat performance so far, but we are coming from an 8% run-up in the first 3 months of the year. So how low can we go if you're seeing more downside risks?
So I think it's also important to kind of take a look at it's still not a matter of whether there will be rate cuts, right? It's just getting pushed back. So you're seeing this weakness, but overall, we expect to see a resurgence of buying appetite towards the end of the year, right? Mm-hmm. Or in the next few months, as we see firmer rate cut timing prospects materialize, right? Mm-hmm. I think right now it's just that it's better to manage your exposures because there's a lot that's still in flux. Right. So from the short term, you've seen the PSEI fall around 7% in a span of a couple of weeks, right? And I think that's too fast, too soon. So we might see a relief rally in the near term. But from a fundamental standpoint, what does that mean, right? We think that obviously expectations still for this year is earnings growth of close to 10%. So a 10% rise in equity markets or in the index is really just factoring in that earnings growth, right? In terms of valuations, we're very closer. We're under where we were last year. Mm-hmm. So I think there's still, obviously, there's still room to move to the upside over the coming months, given, of course, what we know now. But again, a key catalyst here is going to be those rate cuts. And of course, one risk that markets are factoring in right now is what's going to happen in the Middle East. So hopefully that used to be status quo, at least it escalates.
You know, everybody talks about the saying, sell in May and go away. Now I started to hear a new saying that says April showers could bring May flowers. So hopefully these are just, you know, the thunderstorms will see the market bloom soon. Speaking of a relief rally, Restine, you were just talking about it. We are seeing the index bounce back again today following that steep drop earlier this week. The PSEI in the first 6 minutes of trade for the day up by 0.6%, 40 points. We're at 64.89. The broader all shares also in the positive territory, up by 0.4%, 34.45. Most everybody, if you look at the sub-indices, are in positive territory firmly, except for two. Industrials down by a fifth, and mining and oil down by 0.03%. You know, one other thing traders have been watching in the last couple of days is the U.S. dollar that's on rampage. This rally in the dollar this year, it wasn't really expected to happen. Many forecasters, in fact, had predicted a pullback on the assumption that, you know, the Federal Reserve was retreating. The Federal Reserve said that inflation was retreating suddenly. The economy is cooling enough to warrant some reduction in interest rates. When you've got the peso, for example, at the 57 to the dollar handle, and you've got other currencies from South Korea to Indonesia also seeing weakness, they say it's not that we're weak, it's that the dollar is just strong. But however way you look at it, the numbers don't lie. Do you think it is too soon, too abrupt for central banks to start intervening in the forex market?
Well, I mean, obviously, your different central banks have different strategies as to how they'll address that, right, the dollar strength. But I think the BSP's already come out with saying that they're comfortable, right, around 57. So I guess it's really, again, it was a different world last week, right?
Certainly feels like it.
Right. So there's so much developments over a span of a short time. And I think a lot of what's happening is really just not thinking too much about it and then just pulling back on your bullish bets, given your expectations at the start of the year, right? So I think as we move ahead into the following months, we're going to see the Fed have its policy meeting. We might see better indications as to how those rate cuts are going to come, probably, if not in September, probably towards the fourth quarter. So again, we'll see how that comes to play. But I think right now, we're really just reacting to how news flows have been coming in, the economic data coming out of the U.S. And that has been particularly strong enough to warrant
And do you think, and Rustine, do you think the buck stops at 57 to the dollar, or could we be looking at a 58, 59 for the rest of the year?
I can't really speak to how that's going to play out, right? But I think the important thing to monitor here is that if you see rate cuts coming into play in the next several months, then there's also the dollar should start to weaken, right? So I think that's how we should generally expect things
all right
to go.
And Rustine, just wanted to bring in from the BAP, the Philippine peso opening slightly firmer, 57.15 against the greenback from yesterday's close of 57.18. I just wanted to update again our PSEI number. We're about 9 minutes into trade. We are widening the gains. We are trying to claw back some of the what that was 2.4% drop the other day. We're right now up by 0.75%, 64.99. It looks like 64 is holding as a pretty strong and solid support. I wanted to go over some interesting corporate stories that we have. We have this just in, Balaini Frutas. This was the sweet deal that people had been talking about for days. We were waiting for this. Balaini Frutas has entered into an agreement to buy the 40-year-old Sugar House brand. Just very quickly, how do you see this affecting Balaini Frutas? They've been on, you know, the group of Lester Yu behind Frutas Holdings and Balaini Frutas have been on a shopping spree after Lingnam and then now this Sugar House. It's, as I mentioned, it's a 40-year brand. They did not specify the price tag for this deal, so it's less than the threshold amount. But they did say that the acquisition will allow it to expand its product offerings, particularly in the cake category, and tap a broader customer base. They will gain additional production capacity to fuel growth. And synergies are expected with existing brands. The acquisition includes assets such as intellectual property, technical know-how, the commissary and store equipment. Balai will also be taking over the catering business of Sugar House. Completion is expected to take place on or before May 1st of this year. Just very quickly, is this something to cheer about for shareholders of Balaini Frutas, or could this strategy be, you know, could it feel tired and overused already?
I think, obviously, if it's a good price, right? And if you're acquiring a business that it's current business, so obviously the prospects are pretty rosy for you to be doing that. So obviously top line gains, and then eventually you're going to start improvements in margins, because again, if you're seeing some synergies, then what you're really looking for is to add value on that front, right? Mm-hmm. And then of course you're going to be expanding that. So I think over the long term should be good, but of course how that plays into how the margin expansion is going to be, the pace on that obviously is one that should be closely monitored. So I think let's wait and see how that plays out. Hopefully that improves both top line and bottom line very fast.
And I guess everyone wants to know, was the price right? So we're going to have Frutas executive on the show tomorrow. So hopefully we can get more details on that. Another story we have from this morning is Trina Solar and Petrogreen Energy of the Yuchenko Group, Petro Energy Resources Corporation, rather, are partnering to accelerate Philippine solar adoption with a 117 megawatt master supply agreement. Under that MSA, Trina Solar will supply 117 megawatts of high performance PV solar modules to various projects in the Philippines, spearheaded by Petrogreen's subsidiary, Rizal Green Energy Corporation. So, we know that this partnership is poised to significantly contribute to the Philippine government's target of 35% renewable energy by the year 2030. Are you still a big believer in RE? We've seen recently how the stock prices have fallen from highs. What do you think? Overstretched?
I think there's a lot more room to go higher. I think if you look at the energy situation, right, you have a moratorium on new coal plants. So a lot of the incremental demand needs to come from renewable energy or some transition fuel. So I think overall, it's just, again, if the highest cost of your solar companies is the cost to build or the capex. So if you're in a high interest rate environment, obviously, they're very sensitive to that, right? So that plays into the economics of the business. So I think a lot of the weakness is also because financing costs are pretty elevated at this point. Now, hopefully, again, as we see that coming off of highs and towards the end of the year into next, then those stock prices should continue to improve. You have the demand outlook pretty firm as well, right? Our economies continue to grow, so obviously the demand will follow that trajectory.
All right. I think we're now ready for your blind item. Talk to us about this stock that you're monitoring closely and that you like. Don't tell us. Just describe what you have for us today, Restine.
Okay, so this stock is one of the largest players in a sector that's generally seen as a beneficiary for higher for longer interest rates. It's set to be one of the first few companies to report results for the first quarter, with street expectations of earnings growth this year of a little under 10%. Mm-hmm. From a technical standpoint, this company is set to complete a nearly two-month consolidation. And of course, the firming outlook for a higher for even longer interest rates could provide a fresh boost of inflows to the stock. So potential upside from a technical, I think also from a street fair value estimate perspective is a little under 15%, so around 10 to 15. Yeah.
10 to 15, even though the stock price is looking pretty top-ish?
Well, I think if we take a look at the stock, it's actually been a bit more resilient compared to a lot of others. So I think a reason for that is obviously it's a beneficiary of the higher for longer interest rate, or at least that's
all right. We're just going to have to guess which stock this is, but I think it's an easy giveaway. But we'll see. Restine, always a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much for joining us and for the insights on the market. We'll see you soon.
Thank you for having me. Have a great week ahead.
All right. Now, time to zip through the top headlines from major business papers from Business World. U.S.-based exploration startup Oceanex in talks with the Philippine government to conduct marine research in Philippine waters next year to help determine and take advantage of the potential of Manila's blue economy. From Business Mirror, a report from cybersecurity company Kaspersky has found that Philippines faced approximately 1.5 million local threats targeting organizations last year. We're actually at number 5 when you look at the number of local threats in Southeast Asia. And guess who's at number 1? Vietnam, which saw the most number of threats at, get this, 17.1 million, followed by Indonesia at 16.4 million, and Thailand at 4.7 million. So in context, our 1.7 looks pretty okay. And from the Philippine Daily Inquirer, Philippine President Marcos urging the public to work together to adopt energy-saving measures to reduce electricity consumption. This as power supply problems continue to hound Luzon and Visayas after more than 30 power plants remained offline or continue to operate at lower capacities yesterday, Wednesday. Now, here's a quick look at the flash business headlines from overseas. U.S. President Joe Biden calls China xenophobic, while highlighting the economic powerhouse's economic woes as he sought to make the case for U.S. economic strength during a campaign stop in the swing state of Pennsylvania. The president's comments follow a phone call just 2 weeks ago with Chinese President Xi Jinping, their first since their face-to-face meeting in November last year. And efforts to force TikTok's Chinese parent company ByteDance to divest its ownership of the social media platform would quickly become law because under a plan outlined Wednesday by House Speaker Mike Johnson, he plans to include the divest or ban bill in a package of fast-moving bills that provide new aid for Ukraine and Israel. The House is expected to pass the bills this Saturday, and the Senate is expected to quickly consider the legislation. And Japan and the U.S. agreed to closely communicate on currency markets, according to Japanese Finance Minister Shunichi Suzuki, following his meeting with U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen. Suzuki shares he expressed their desire for exchange rates to move stably, reflecting fundamentals and assuring that Japan will respond to excessive currency moves. Suzuki, of course, is visiting Washington to attend this week's IMF and G20 finance leaders gathering. Foreign holdings of U.S. Treasury surged 8.7% to a new record in February. That is the fifth straight monthly rise, according to the U.S. Treasury Department. Holdings totaled $7.965 trillion. Now, holdings of treasuries grew the most in Belgium by $27 billion to $320 billion, while Japan, the largest non-U.S. holder of treasuries, increased its government debt holdings to $1.167 trillion. That is the largest since August of 2022. And finally, United Airlines will receive compensation from plane maker Boeing for financial damages incurred in the first quarter due to the grounding of 737 MAX 9 aircraft. U.S. regulators had in January grounded some of those aircraft for about 3 weeks for safety checks after a cabin panel blowout on an Alaska Airlines-operated MAX 9 jet. The incident had forced United Airlines, a prominent Boeing customer, to temporarily suspend service on all 79 of its 737 MAX 9 aircraft, which resulted in a $200 million hit for the airline in the first quarter. We now shift our focus to a Filipino pride who brings life and motion to scribbles and sketches. His love for animation led to him bagging awards here at home and abroad. Recently, his film Sulaiman won the Best Animated Film in the Pensacon Short Film Festival 2024, the largest pop culture convention in the Gulf Coast. To talk more about his work and the business of animation, we are now joined by animation director Nelson Blog Caligua. Hi, Nelson. Welcome to Market Edge. Congratulations.
Thank you. Hello, Michelle. Good morning, and thank you for having me. Glad to be here.
And let's not forget, you are a grantee of a CCP yes. Innovation funding. How much funding did CCP give you that allowed you to complete this project?
We were fortunate enough as a group. We applied for the grant as a group as Tuldok Animation Studios. It's a nonprofit organization focused on original Filipino animation. And as a group, we were able to get around 500,000 pesos to create three projects. Mm-hmm. So to be honest, no, it's not much, but we pursued it like passion projects. It began during the pandemic, and we continued to work on it for on and off while we were also working on other things.
All right. And Blog, you know, they say there's no business like show business. And this is really an interesting part of show business, animation. How is the animation industry today? Is it harder to land projects? Is it harder to sell and to offer your creations? Is money harder to come by?
Yeah, I think traditionally the Philippine animation industry has been linked as a service provider for foreign animation studios. So traditionally, that has been the role of many of our fellow Filipinos working in the industry. I think the current thrust lately has been more towards creating our own content, creating our own intellectual properties. It hasn't yet bloomed yet the way that the service provider industry has bloomed, but I think it is the path forward when it comes to generating more opportunities for our local animation artists.
Mm-hmm. All right. And so let's talk about your own content, your winning content. This is the story of Indara Patra and Sulaiman. It is actually a Mindanao folklore. I know it's about a story about two brothers. The king had asked his brother Sulaiman to check out another island or province where, you know, big birds and monster animals were attacking. Very quickly, tell us the story of Sulaiman. And it has been told and retold many times in many different ways. What makes your version different, unique?
Yes. The thrust of our proposal to CCP when we engaged on the CCP innovation grants was to promote local myths and legends. So I was tasked to create the animated short film based on a Mindanaoan folktale. My interpretation for this one was I simplified the story out of necessity because the story is only 8 minutes. So it was also a bit of a technical challenge. So I needed to compress the story. I simplified it. I mainly focused more on Sulaiman's adventure and his sacrifice, his heroic sacrifice. So it is a more concise version of the folktale, but I still made sure that the heroic side of the characters is in full display, especially when it comes to this adventurous action scene.
How many artists worked on this 8-minute film? And for how long?
Since this is, comparatively speaking, a low-budget passion project, majority of the work was made by myself. Mm-hmm. For the most part, a lot of the rough animation has been made by myself. But I also had some assistants, particularly interns, and a couple of professional friends that were pitching in here and there with a little bit of tasks that they were helpful enough to help me out with during their free time.
So what happens to this animated film now? Since it's a winner, where do you take this next?
Yep. Sulaiman right now is currently on its film festival tour. I have been submitting it to various film festivals, and so far it has been accepted into 18 international film festivals. I have been submitting since September last year. So currently the count is around 18 international festivals, and I still aim to continue submitting it to festivals. And when its festival run ends, I hope to also promote it online.
Ah, all right, all right. Blog, I'm very curious how you feel artificial intelligence will change the game for animation artists like yourselves. I mean, the founder of DreamWorks, I think last year said that, you know, it used to take us 5 years and 500 artists to create one world-class animated movie. With artificial intelligence, it's going to take us less than 10% of that. Expect a 90% cut in costs. While the idea will come from individual creativity, the execution can be carried out by machines. What are your thoughts on this? And should artists, you know, Filipino artists who are just about to come out of their shell, start to worry that they will be crowded out?
Yes, actually, this is a currently hot topic right now, especially among us artists, just in general, not just animators, but just artists in general. There's a lot of debate about AI. It has arrived, and I think it's here to stay. So it's just a matter of navigating around it now that this technological phenomena has already arrived. I have been talking to other famous directors, animation directors, and local animation artists, and to be frank, they are worried. They do not. If we want to be optimistic about it, maybe we could coexist harmoniously with this new technology, and the job market would not be disrupted. But I think, to be honest, I think it will disrupt the job market, especially here in the Philippines, that the local animation industry is primarily geared towards being a service provider. So I think the challenge now, especially to local artists, is to maybe shift the focus to content creation, since especially if AI's positive impact to the industry is that it would make the production side less painstaking, and there's less investment in terms of manpower and labor, maybe we could refocus and shift towards IP development instead. But again, there's no clear answer right now, and I'm sure that when, especially a few years from now, it's really going to affect our media landscape in a big way.
Final question, Blog. You know, they say that there's a saying, the starving artist. They say that, you know, artists don't really make a lot until they make a very big boom, until their name really explodes in the scene. I wonder, what can government do for you? Because we haven't really seen the Philippine animation scene, you know, go full blast yet. It's like it's been trying to take off, but not quite. Is there anything that you think this government can do, not just grants, not just a 500,000 grant, for example, but to push, you know, for you guys to finally hit inflection point and just go, wow, explode?
Yeah, maybe I could speak on my recent encounter ahead. With another opportunity with CCP as well. So this artwork, by the way, in my background, this is the project that we are currently producing right now. It is another animated short film based on Lola Bashang. This is funded by CCP as well, and it's already near completion. It's 99% complete. I think we will be finished by May.
Okay.
So by May, we were already finished. The budget here is, I'm happy to say, is a bit more improved compared to the CCP Innovation Grant. So we had better budget now. We had more finances and resources to gather people to help us. But again, to the question of what more can the government do, and I think a more sustained effort, because right now it's somewhat sporadic when it comes to support. It does exist, the support does exist, but it's a bit more sporadic here and there. So I think a more sustained effort and a more long-term view about how we can get a return on investment with regards to these projects, because it is a big risk, because animation typically is more expensive and more time consuming than live action projects. So I think when we're tackling this type of projects, we have to think a couple of steps ahead when it comes to getting our investments back.
All right, Blog, we don't have much time, but thank you so much for sharing with us this passion, the projects that you're working on, and congratulations again. You make us proud.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
All right. Now, before we go for those Strive Guest Blind item, this is the pick of Rustine. 10-15% upside. This stock is, drumroll please, BPI. Do list if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that's it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you all so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.
They can still afford, because we bring down the container of toothpaste from the regular tubes, which is 30-40%.